Good evening. How are y'all doing tonight? Good to see y'all out here on a Saturday night. I always like Saturday night because you don't come to church on Saturday night unless you want to. You know what I mean? Some people come on Sunday morning out of like an obligation or, you know, we call it getting your religious parking ticket validated, but getting your thing punched to go to heaven. But when you come out on a Saturday night, you hungry. You thirsty for the living God. Hallelujah. Let's invite him here tonight. Say, living God, we've invited you with our praise. We've invited you with our worship. Lord, we've even given and of our finances and our time. We're here tonight, Lord Jesus, not only to worship, not only to give, but to receive from your word, from your spirit. Lord, we don't take one move of your spirit, one word uttered, an unction by your spirit. We don't take it for granted. Lord, there have been generations that lived and died and never experienced your presence. So we are thankful for your presence here tonight. Lord, we are thankful. We're a thankful people. And we thank you for teaching us your word. Lord, we don't approach your word as a history lesson. We approach your word as a living word, as though you're speaking it personally to us here tonight. And Holy Spirit, we know that without you, we can't comprehend it. And so we ask for your help in understanding the principles, the person of Christ. We ask that you would explain on the inside of us the Word of God. Help us to grab hold of it and let that Word be engrafted into our souls, that our minds may be renewed by the washing of the water of the Word. We exalt the Word of God as well as the person and the presence of God here tonight. We know that without the Word, we're in trouble. Without the presence, we're in trouble. We want them both in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we get into it tonight, I got a little video I want to show you. This song was shared with us this week, and I was just, when I heard it, I was moved in my spirit because I recognize how hard it is to get people to walk in unity. It is very difficult in any culture, in any church. I remember several years ago I went to Africa, and I was with an evangelist, and we ministered for a couple of weeks in Africa, and we had incredible crusades. And this evangelist said to me, he said he stayed in Africa for 7 years. And I said, so you're going to stay? And he's like, I'm staying. He moved his family there, came home, sold everything you own, I'll never forget what he said to me. He said, David, he said, the African people are not like Americans. He said, they just want Jesus because of the meetings we'd had there. They just want Jesus. He said, they ain't into all this political crap and all these church wars. They just want Jesus. And I said, really? He said, that's right. 7 years later, he moved back to America. He was barely saved. I'm serious. When I say barely saved, he was so angry, he forsook ministry and started a secular business, laid in his house and watched movies every night instead of preaching the gospel to the world because he was so angry because of the political maneuvers he had experienced in the church in Africa. I said, brother, it's everywhere. I don't care if you're in any group of people, human nature is human nature. Everybody say this with me. Same devil, different face. Same devil, different race. Same devil, different nation. The devil's the same. He's never changed his strategies in 6,000 years, and I just got the sneaking suspicion he's not going to change them today. He just packages them for our current culture. But there's a group, Casting Crowns, and they released an album here last year. And this is a song on the album that really articulates, I think, the heartbreak of the Lord concerning our division in the body of Christ. And so I want to play this little video for you before we get into the Word tonight. Because tonight, what we're going to minister is a message. I've called it Boundaries. As you know, we're focusing on boundaries now. Boundaries and the gifted church. Boundaries and the gifted church. And tonight, we're going to get into that. So, years of Christianity, and not a whole lot has changed. Can you say amen? Why? Because we all have a human nature. We all have a fallen nature, and we all have an opportunity to serve a new nature. And as you know, those words were coming forth tonight. I just want to recap, and let's move into this message tonight: boundaries and the gifted church. We ended up last Wednesday in this scripture, Romans 13:1. Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities. Everybody say, let every soul. That would be me. Be subject to governing authorities. You know, there's a lot of people who think they don't need authority. They think they're their own authority. But in reality, we all need authority in our life. Why? Because we can't trust ourselves. Over the last 28 years of pastoring the church, I'm telling you, I have been amazed at what people called God. I've been amazed at what people chose and then justified through their desires. And it was as unrighteous could be, but yet the desire was so strong, they chose their emotion and their desire over the truth. We're no different. Turn to your neighbor and say, all of us need God's authority in our lives. Amen. Now, we looked at the home with this Wednesday night. It says, therefore, in verse 2, whoever resists authority resists the ordinance of God. Now, why am I teaching this tonight? Because I want every one of us to experience God's best. I want every one of us to experience God's best. But see, there's a condemning part to this, and this is the next part. It says, whoever resists God resists the ordinance of God, resists God, and those who resist will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Do you want to be unafraid of authority? Do what is good, and you'll have praise from the same. You know, I've passed probably a dozen policemen this week, and I've not shuddered under fear of any of them. But a few years ago, well, 30 years ago, more than a few now, every time I passed a cop, I got sick to my stomach. Why? Because I knew my car had things in it that I could be arrested for, things like marijuana or alcohol, open flask. And so every time I drove by a cop, I'd get this nauseated feeling inside. You know, anytime I was around authority and I was breaking a law, there was a certain, as the scripture says, a certain expectation of judgment. But when I'm doing what's right, I don't have any fear of authority. You know, when I'm living righteous and I'm living for the Lord and I'm living in His kingdom, you know, when we talk about the fear of God, I'm not afraid that God's going to hurt me, that God's going to judge me, that God's going to condemn me. I have no fear of that tonight at all. None. The fear I have is if I ever come out from under His authority, then I face that certain expectation of coming judgment, if I ever come out from His authority. And this helps me be self-adjusting in my behavior. It helps me stay right in line with His kingdom principles and person and nature. Now, in today's culture, we live in America and we are under a capitalistic democracy, and theology is in direct conflict with democracy when it comes to government. God declares His rule of law is absolute and sovereign. He declares that. He said, I am God, and besides me, there is no other. Period. What I say is right, and all else is wrong. That's what God says. That's absolute authority. So God's way of governing is different than our American culture. I've preached the gospel in different nations, and one thing I learned as a young man when I was traveling around the world is when I would go into a nation, the church would often reflect the national government in its government. I remember when I went to Romania right after Ceausescu was assassinated and or killed, when right after that I went in there. Well, Romania had been a communist rule under this communist regime. And when we started going into the churches looked like communism. They ruled like communism. They had a reflection of the government. Well, when you come into an American church, now I was in Mozambique, and we went to a church in Maputo, Mozambique, which is the capital of Mozambique, and we were in a church that had 60,000 members preaching. There were six services on Sunday, 10,000 in each service in attendance. And the pastor was also the tribal chief. And he ruled in tribal rule. He actually carried a whip in his briefcase. And if a saint got out of line, he could flog him. Yeah. That was why. That was the tribal rule. The tribal elders had the responsibility of disciplining the people. It's kind of like if you go out west to the Indian reservations, they have their own rule of law. They're autonomous from our American laws because the reservation is a nation, and so they have their own police force, they have their own laws on the reservation. Well, we live in a democratic society, in a democratic rule, and from children, all of us are raised to live in a majority rule. And we're comfortable with that. And I really believe that democratic rule as a civil law in ruling is great, but it's only great as long as there is a moral majority. The minute the majority becomes immoral, corruption takes over and the nation erodes. Now, as society continues to relax the absolute law of God, we're eroding in our society of America like a hillside that you've taken all the trees off of. You know, if you pull all the vegetation off of land and there's a hill, what happens to it? It erodes. And when there's erosion, nothing can grow. And this is a picture of what's happening to America. We lost the moral majority in the last 10 years. We lost it. We're no longer a majority. The Christian principle, the law of God, is no longer absolute rule in America. Now, a lot of people are not comfortable with this kind of government. A lot of people are not comfortable with absolute rule. And I understand that. Why? Because in an autocratic rule, people say there's too much chance for corruption. In fact, it's been said, and I would probably agree with this, the purest form of government in a civil nation, you know, civil government is a dictatorship. However, a dictator can't be trusted. Why? Because dictators always get corrupted. You know, the old saying, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. So if that dictator does not have a moral basis that he's ruling out of, then dictatorships don't work. So communism doesn't work. Why? Corruption. Dictatorships don't work. Why? Corruption. Democracies don't work. Why? Corruption. A lot of people say, well, I'm not comfortable, you know, in an autocratic rule because, you know, there's a chance for corruption. Well, for example, in this church was built with the foundation of an autocratic rule. That simply means I'm in charge. Everybody say, Dave's in charge. Now, we designed the church this way. Why? I believe it's the biblical pattern. Now, as I lead this house and this vision and this ministry, I too am a man under authority, and I'm under the authority of the government of the King of Heaven. That's my authority. And so I stand under him, as well as with a council of people. And so I think that with, you know, a lot of people say, well, I don't want to be in a church where there's an autocratic rule. I'd rather be in a church where there's a democratic rule. Why? It's safer. Really? You really believe that? Well, let's just examine the Church of America as she's been democratically ruled for the last 200 years. We have tens of thousands of churches that haven't seen a move of the Holy Spirit in 100 years. Deader than a doormat nail, being led by people who are not even converted. Don't have enough power to blow the fuzz off a peanut. I mean, we're talking about dead church in America. How did that happen under a democratic rule if it's safer? Here's the bottom line. Whenever you remove the moral foundation or the absolute good and evil teaching of God's word from any form of government, it falls. Whether it's a democratic or a autocratic or a communistic, whenever corruption comes in, government will erode. Because the root system that holds that thing together is the moral fiber. And when you remove it, it's a disaster. Amen? So we in this church have a little different philosophy than most churches. In this church, you know, we push an agenda of that's different than most American churches. As you've seen demonstrated here, we have extended times of worship. That is spirit. We call it being spirit-led. In other words, we give the worship leaders the responsibility to pray and to seek God for an agenda each service, and then we give them the parameters to go outside the, quote, you know, structure of the service for spontaneous spiritual unctions. That's how I see church, based on the scriptures. And the church, of course, will always be a reflection of the senior leader of that church. If the senior leader is given to spontaneous, unctional, spiritual services, the church will be. If the leader is not, the church won't be. I'm not saying God doesn't bless either one. He blesses both. You know, God blesses dead churches. And by dead churches, I mean churches that resist the living, unctional flow of the Spirit. God blesses them. Why? Some people will never go any further than that. They'll never go any further than that. Some people, because of unbelief, because of hardness of heart, because who knows why, some people will never go any further than, I believe Jesus is the Son of God, and I believe I'm born again, but I ain't getting into all that Holy Spirit stuff. Some churches like that. And you know what? I let God worry about those. I have to worry about me and what God's called me to do, which is to build spiritual churches or churches that are moving in the Spirit. Well, when you have a spiritual church, a gifted church, a church that moves and exalts in the gifts of the Spirit, you have to have a stronger government to make sure that that thing stays within the boundaries of what God calls right and wrong. Amen? And believe me, we have a lot of history, a lot of church history that shows that men can clear back to the time of Jesus. He prophesied and he said that here's what's going to happen to gifted people. Many are going to come to me in that day saying, Lord, we prophesied in your name, gifted. We cast out devils, gifted. We work miracles, gifted. And Jesus said, I will declare, I never knew you. Depart from me. Now let's qualify the boundary. Ye who work iniquity. So in other words, the gifting didn't qualify, but holiness, sanctification, character, ethics qualified. A lot of times we think gifting qualifies us as spiritual. Gifting is a gift. A lot of times people think that they have a greater access to God or a greater favor of God because they can receive and work in a spiritual gift, which is an act of faith. But you can be gifted. And that's why Paul said, man, you can speak in tongues of men and angels. But if you don't have love, you're a clanging cymbal. Amen. Titus and Timothy give us 13 qualifications of leadership. 12 out of 13 have to do with character. One has to do with gifting. So as we look into this tonight, we're going to set boundaries. And you know, since January, I've had this thing burning in my spirit that we have to have strong boundaries. And I think it's because of the seasons that we're coming into, maybe in our nation, maybe in this church, in our vision, because I know we're coming into a planting season. I think we're going to be planting many churches out of here. And so we need to have these boundaries or our culture set so that we speak the same thing, so that we understand what we're doing. Amen. So let's look into this tonight. We're going to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and we're going to see what Paul said about boundaries in the gifted church. Now, as you know through history, the Corinthian people were a very mystic people. They were very quick to receive the salvation of Christ. And not only were they quick to receive the ministry of salvation, but they were quick to embrace the power of the Holy Spirit. And they were, in fact, the only church where there's a very strong mention of the spiritual gifts flowing and operating. And let's just get into this tonight and walk through it and see what the Bible says. Greeting. Here we go. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother. To the church of God which is at Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all who labor in every place, who call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always concerning you, for the grace of God which was given to you by Jesus Christ, that you were enriched in everything by Him, in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come short in no gift. Everybody say, the gifted church. Everybody say it a little louder. The gifted church. You know, I was on the phone earlier with a minister earlier today, and he made a statement. He said, David, you draw a lot of gifted people to your church. So he said, I have pastors calling me saying, where in the heck, how do you get these worship people to come to you? Yeah. I say, well, I let them use their gifts. You know, I've talked to frustrated worship leaders before, as Larry can talk to, and they're frustrated because they'll pray and seek God all week long, and they'll think they got a flow of the service, and the pastor will walk in and say, I want this song, this song, this song, this song. You have 21 minutes and you better not go over. You're allowed 3 songs tonight, and that's it. And they're frustrated. And so I was with a group of pastors one day, And we were talking about this, and they were saying, man, you get such great worship team in your church. And I looked at him, I said, you disrespect your worship leaders. That's why they won't come to you. You will not allow them to move in their gifts and their callings. You want to put them on your little time clock. You want to control them, and you won't let them seek God and express their gifts. Instead, you just try to micromanage every song. And I said, that's why you don't have any worship leaders. Well, amen. The gifted church. Amen. You got so many people that prophesy. I don't know why no one in my church prophesies. Well, do you let them? Do you let them? Most churches are so worried about 60 minutes, getting the people out the back doors in 60 minutes. We were talking with a couple one day, and I laughed so hard. They come to this church, and they were so celebrated and celebrating the freedom and the liberty and the spirit of this house. I'll keep the names anonymous to protect the guilty. But the lady made a statement to me. She said, Pastor, I'm just amazed at, I mean, you have a two-hour service or so, and then people still won't leave. They just hang out. She said, the church I've been a part of, she said, after the service, if you went to the bathroom, you'd get locked in. I mean, everybody was like, get out of here. We've been here an hour. I can't take it anymore. Ah! Present, you know. I remember the first church I was a part of, I'll never forget this day because it was my first, I think, revelation of religion, because I was in the newlywed season with Jesus, man, just being saved and delivered. And I was going to this little church, and the pastor was teaching one Sunday morning, and he was teaching on Elisha. And I'll never forget this because he was talking about why God chose Elisha to replace Elijah. And he kept hammering on this fact. In the middle of a famine, he was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen. That's 24 cows. Think about it. In a famine, this guy just had a won't quit spirit. Ground got harder, he just hooked another team up, you know. And he was talking about it. And I mean, I was on the edge of my seat, man. I was just like this. All of a sudden, he just stopped. I felt like I was... If someone told me one day, I did that one day in a service, I just stopped in the middle of a real hot part of the message. Someone said, man, I felt like you slammed me up against a windshield. It's just like, what happened, you know? And that's the way I felt that day. And I walked up to the pastor, and I said, brother, why did you stop? That was so good. And he said, just as innocent as a little child, he said, well, Dave, the Cowboys are playing today. If I don't have them out of here by 12 o'clock, they'll have the pulpit committee will have me on the rug Sunday or Monday morning. And he was as serious as a heart attack. And I'm a newborn Christian. And I'm like, huh? What do you mean the Cowboys are playing? We trump God's spirit with the Cowboys playing? I mean, I'm in confusion now. I'm like, whoa. Amazing. But when you have gifted church and gifted people, we also have problems. Hence why many churches don't allow giftings. God is faithful, verse 9, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, in my Bible, under this next section, there was a subtitle, and here's what it said. Sectarianism is sin. Okay, just remember that. Sectarianism is sin. Now, I plead with you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing. Sounds like religious cloning to me, Paul. Sounds like you're trying to brainwash them, Corinthians. Wow, it got quiet all of a sudden. That you all speak the same thing. That there be no divisions among you. Now, the word division means two visions. In other words, I see this and you see that. He said that there be no, there aren't two visions among you.
Well, I know Pastor Dave thinks the church ought to be doing this, but I think the church ought to be doing that.
Shut up. Or you could get yourself in trouble. Why? God doesn't want two visions. Now, under one vision comes multiple visions. But all visions come under one vision. All visions come under one vision. The vision of a house is like an umbrella. And under that umbrella, many visions can gather. Like we have a vision in this church of worship. We have a vision of developing people in their spiritual giftings and in their ministry giftings and even in their natural giftings. We have a vision of evangelism to reach the lost at any cost. We have a vision of evangelism. We literally worked our fingers to the bone last year winning souls because we were in a season of harvest. Some people during the season of harvest said we ought to be doing this instead. There may be people here tonight and you say, you know, Dave, I think we should be doing this instead.
Well, I pray that we all speak the same thing. Now, here's the thing. When you come into a church, you come into the vision of the leader. I'm the leader.
Some people say, I don't agree with your vision. Then this ain't your church. I say that with love. I don't say that saying, get out of here. I say that saying, we can't work together unless we're under one vision. That's just common sense. I mean, can you imagine going to work, Barb? Can you imagine going to work Monday morning and you work under a doctor, right? No, you don't. Where you work under who? Yourself. Let me pick someone else. Okay. I got myself in trouble on that one, didn't I? Kalita, I'll pick you. Okay, Kalita. She's volunteering. She works under a group of attorneys, and you show up Monday morning, and they say, Kalita, this is our vision. This is what our law firm is going to do this week, and this is what I want you to do. Imagine what would happen if Kalita said to Mr. Bowles or Mr. Rice, or, I'm sorry, that's not what I was thinking for this week. In fact, I think we ought to do this instead. Well, they would probably look at her and say, well, maybe you shouldn't be working for us then. That's in the normal world government. But for some reason, people think when they come into a church that there's no corporate vision to submit to. There's no direct leadership to submit to. Everybody just wants to do their own thing. Why? Well, you know, that's just que sera, sera, man. It's just whatever I think I want to do, I want to do. No, that's not how it works. We got to be brought under one vision. We got to learn to speak the same thing if we're going to have a greater accomplishment. Now, my pastor always said this, and I agree with this 100%. He said, partners catch more fish. How many of y'all know you can have a lot more effect on a community? You know, I'm not really a big numbers guy. I mean, everybody likes to have more people, I guess. Anybody does. But at the same time, I've learned that with a greater amount of people, you can have a greater impact on a community. With a smaller amount of people, you don't have a big impact on your community. We had a great impact on our community last year where almost 8,000 people came through this church in 9 months. And a couple of thousand of them said yes to Jesus because we had a labor force. We had 100 and some people working in a drama for the harvest.
We had you guys all out there working the streets, inviting people to come, working together. And together, look what we did. But the devil knows that. So what he tries to do is he tries to get us in division. Why? He knows that if he can splinter us up into a bunch of little Bible studies, we'll never have any impact on any region. Whenever we come together, it is so important that we realize the big picture, the purpose we're here. Now, I plead with you. Imagine Paul pleading. I plead with you. Why? By the name of Jesus, that you all speak the same thing, there be no divisions among you, that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and the same judgment. Everybody say, assimilated into the mind of Christ. For it has been declared to me concerning you, my brethren, by those of Chloe's household, that there are contentions among you. Now, the word contention comes from a Greek word called eros, and here's what it means. Conflict resulting from rivalry and discord. It means always saying bad things about one another, never having a good word to say about one another. Contentions among you. As we grow as a church, we have to guard this beautiful gift we've been given. We have to guard this beautiful banner that we're flying under. Why? Everybody say, same devil, different face. Same devil, different year. It's no different. You know, in the last year, I've seen more contention in this church than in the last 13 years. I'm teaching this on Saturday night because you're the core. And you guys have to assimilate this out into the body. You're the guys that are influencing people to come. You're the guys that are either going to make this ship sail and make this plane fly, or sink the ship, or crash the airplane. Amen? We got to work hard to realize the enemy would like nothing better than to fragment us so that there's never another move of God like what happened in this place last year. Boy, he would love to shut the sound of this worship team down. There ain't nothing he'd like more than to shut down those prophetic declarations. Something happened here a few weeks ago, and I'm telling you, I have been humbled by it. One night, I taught on prophecy, and I had all you all prophesy to each other. The testimonies, I mean, to me, it was a very simple thing. The testimonies that came out of that night humbled me to a point of saying, my God, we don't even know what we have. People were set free from years of oppression as you turned one to another and said, I believe I hear the Lord saying to you. Homes were restored. I got the testimonies, man. Lives were changed by 5 minutes of spontaneous spiritual ministry. Things were done. One man said to me, I've been in this church for 6 months, and what happened in that 5 minutes changed me more than the whole 6 months put together. That was one testimony. That's crazy, ain't it? Why? A word spoken in due season is like an apple of gold in a frame of silver. Man, the power of, at the time to hear the right thing at the wrong time. I was in Jackson Thursday night, and I don't prophesy a lot in this church. Why? I know you guys too much. I do sometimes, but I try to avoid saying anything I know. But I got kind of excited. I went down to Jackson and preached Thursday night, and there was a bunch of new people that I didn't ever see before, so I just started prophesying over them. Well, I didn't know them. I wanted to hear from the Lord. And this one guy, man, I started giving him a prophetic word, and I was driving back from Jackson about 11:30 that night. Larry and I were driving back, and Pastor Brian texts me and calls me and says, or maybe it was the next morning. I think it was the next morning. He called me. He said, you know, last night, he said, this guy called back to church. He goes, how'd that guy know all that stuff about me? Rocked his world. I guarantee you what happened in that two-minute prophetic word rocked him probably more than every sermon he'd heard for the last month. Why? Because when something becomes a personal revelation through that activation anointing, man, it's life-changing. Now, on the other hand, sometimes a word preached will shake a person to their core. Sometimes a preached word will move. Sometimes it's a song that is sang. We need all of it. We need all of it. But here's the danger in a gifted church. Verse 12, now I say this, that each of you says, I'm of Paul, or I'm of Apollos, or I'm of Cephas, or I'm of Christ. Is Christ divided? Now, in this church, let's retranslate this for our specific church. Some says, I'm prophetic. I'm evangelistic. I'm a worshiper. I'm in the community. Oh, is Christ divided? And the poets think the dancers are weak. Or, you know, the soldiers think the dancers are weak. And this person thinks this, and this person. And we this thing crept in among us. Like a cancer. Nothing's changed. We're still after God. We're still celebrating His Word and His Spirit. As they agree, why can't we? It's human nature to exalt and elevate your gift or bent above others. But it's not the nature of Christ. Who was greater? Jesus the evangelist, Jesus the prophet, Jesus the teacher, Jesus the apostle, or Jesus the pastor? Who was greatest? Who was right? Isn't it all Jesus? Or Jesus the healer? Or Jesus the deliverer? I thought it was all Jesus. Or Jesus the worshiper? Why you gotta sing them same songs over and over and over? Because Jesus is a worshiper. Why does the same three people have to get up and give a prophecy every service? Because Jesus is a prophet. Why do we got to have them tongues? Because Jesus gave them as a gift to us. And I want to honor and cherish every gift He gave us. Every gift. Watch this. Everybody say, the gifted church must have boundaries. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? Verse 14 is a horrible thing for Paul to have to say, I thank God I baptized none of you. What drove this man to say something like that? Division. Exalting one gift above another. Someone called me a few weeks ago and said, hey Dave, you know there's some guys in your church that think they can do it better than you now. I just kind of giggled inside and said, yeah, I know. Just like a teenager growing up. One day he thinks he can beat dad. But I used to love to arm wrestle my dad. And I just knew one day I was going to take him. Never did, but knew one day I would, you know. And it's like, and I just laughed inside. I said, you know what? I hope you can. I'll never forget, when I joined the Army, I was in conflict with my parents. And I didn't tell them I was joining. I went and joined, and then I came home and told them. And they were very upset. And I was angry at them because I just didn't feel I could get what I needed from them. They didn't have much money. In fact, the conversation my mom had with me when I was a senior in high school was, Dave, we can't send you to college. We don't have the money. That was the conversation we had as a senior in high school. And I didn't hold that against them, but at the same time, I thought, you can't give me what I need, so my ticket out of their home and out of the community was to join the Army. And so when I came home and I joined the Army, I remember I was standing in the living room and I told him, and my mom was very upset, you know, David, why didn't you even ask us about doing this? Why did you do this without even talking to us? And I'm like, it didn't matter. You'd have just said this or this. And I'll never forget, later on, my dad, who was a man of very few words, this is probably one of the longest sentences he ever spoke to me in my life. He made this statement. He said, well, I kind of hoped you'd, you know, because I was his apprentice. That was my job. He was a newspaper printer, and I was the press apprentice. And he said, I kind of hoped you'd, you know, follow after me. And I said, you don't make enough money for me to follow after you. And he looked at me, and I'll never forget, I was so angry. I looked at him, I said, I'll tell you one thing, Dad. When I'm your age, I'll have a lot more than you do. And I'll never forget the next thing he said to me were words that cut me to the heart and made me, humiliated me to a point of self-humiliation. I felt so, I knew I had disrespected my father. He said these words to me, I hope you do, son. I really hope you do. And I realized Dad wasn't against me. He was for me. But he was just trying to help guide me with wisdom. And you know, part of growing up spiritually is you get like a teenager where you think you don't need authority in your life. I can read my own Bible. I can hear from God just like anybody else. And a lot of times what happens in that is a spirit of deception can come in. And where we should have a good consensus of eldership around us, helping us to guard against deception, sometimes that spirit could just slip in before we even know it, man. We're walking outside the will of God. So he said, I thank God I baptized none of you. I never want to have to say that to my church. I don't ever want to have. I mean, I can't imagine getting up here tonight saying, I thank God I didn't baptize any of you. You're so divided. Y'all acting so carnal. I don't ever want to have to say that to a church. But Paul did to the gifted church. It goes on to say, Christ didn't send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be of none effect. Here Paul was declaring that God had given him boundaries of ministry. Every one of us have boundaries of ministry. Every one of us have callings and giftings. And God wants us to stay in those boundaries. God didn't call me to be you, and he didn't call you to be me. He called us to be what he called us to be. And I'm anointed to be me. How about you? Amen. And so as God is calling us, he goes on to say, he was called to preach the gospel as an apostle. He had declared, he said, my goal is to go where Christ has never been preached and preach Christ there. That was Paul's commission, was to go. We would call him today a missionary. The word missionary is not even in the Bible. Isn't it crazy that we take a whole ministry and call it missionary, and that term isn't even, it's not even biblical. Why don't we call a missionary what that missionary really is? Many missionaries really do more the function of a deacon than the function of an apostle. Most missionary endeavors, especially by denominations, are to feed the poor, give them hospitals, build them houses. That's the deacon's ministry. And we call them missionaries. Why don't we call them deacons on assignment? Because that's what they are. Apostles, on the other hand, go into a region to establish the government of God. If you're not governmental in thinking, you're not an apostle. That's not how you think. Now, pastors, they have caring for people on their mind. Teachers, they only want you to make sure that you're doctrinally sound. They're going to do everything in their power to understand. You need to know every jot and tittle of the word. You need to make sure that you're preaching doctrine that is balanced and true. You know, a teacher will be more concerned about whether you're a Calvinist or an Arminianist or a Reformed than whether you're filled with the Spirit. A teacher will. An apostle, he's going to do everything he can to get you seeing Jesus as King and you subject to Him and the kingdom working in balance. Gifts, word, serving, love, evangelism, all of it working in balance. Not too much over here where we're all lopsided. But everything working together so that everything is as much as is possible by the gifts you have with you to make sure that everybody is being equipped to do what they're called to do. That's what an apostle season does. And he wants to do everything in his power. I mean, when I look through my eyeballs in a church, the first thing I want to do is bring it under kingdom administration and government. I want to root out, you know, wrong philosophies. I want to root out democratic rule in a church. Why? That is a doorway to hell. If you get a pastor being voted on, then he's running for re-election every service, and corruption is going to rule and reign him. He can't be ruled by God. He's ruled by you. And how many of y'all know a lot of times God will have you say something the people don't want to hear? Well, then you can't ever confront sin. Especially if your biggest giver is a sinner. Amen. So, for the message of the cross, verse 18, is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God that through the foolishness of the message preached. You know, the world looks at the church and looks at preachers as foolish. Why you go sit and listen to that guy beat his gums every week? Don't you know you're just being brainwashed? When we started our church in Jackson, we were so different than the church culture of that city. They declared us a cult, and they got a nickname for people that sat under me. They called it Chisholmism. Chisholmism. And as all I was doing was teaching the scriptures. Why didn't they call it Jesusism? Because we were just teaching the scriptures. I mean, my preaching is pretty expository. I mean, I go pretty much verse by verse by verse, and I'm very cautious and proof texting. I'm very cautious in pulling one little verse over here and building a doctrine. I'm making sure that you get the whole context. I'd rather preach by chapter than by verse, or by book than by chapter. Because we want to know, well, what exactly was going on here? Why did he say what he said? Why did he say, woman, shut up in the church? Why did he say that? Well, if you don't understand the culture of that time, if you don't know what the word woman means there, then you will just think women aren't allowed to talk in church. So you have to go back and you have to put that in context with culture. You have to put it in context with what the words actually mean. Did you know the word woman there actually means wife or married woman? And in that culture, it was a public offense for a woman to speak to her husband. She was to ask him when he got home. That was the culture at that time. Well, we don't live in that culture anymore. So that scripture doesn't really apply to us because our culture's changed. Now, does there still need to be a submission between a wife and a husband? Does the male still carry the authority of God over the woman? Yes. That's the way God created us. So we still give a hierarchy in the sense of, but now let's balance that. In Christ, there's no longer male nor female, but we're like the angels. Everybody say, balance it. Well, if there's no longer male nor female in Christ, then we no longer exalt man above woman. You know, when I got married in Korea, my wife walks, and to this day, if you ever watch when Kyung and I are in public, she will walk behind me usually 5 to 10 feet. That's a Korean culture. When you're in Korea, this has changed. Korea, I believe they just got a woman president, didn't they? Just elected a woman president, man, that's crazy. Because when I was in Korea, man was here and woman was here. And that's how they were trained. But that culture's changed now. Now, here's the beauty of it. You know when that culture changed? When Christianity became a revival in Korea, all of a sudden women stopped being looked at as second-class citizens. In fact, Christianity is the only culture on planet Earth that calls women to equality with men in rights. They're the only Christian nations. Only Christian nations. You go over to other nations and women don't have, we were walking on a hillside in Israel one day. I had a group of about 7 of us pastors. We're walking along a hillside and all of a sudden these Arab women came by and they had the head covering and the thing over their face where you just see their eyes. And as they were walking by, this one pastor I was with, he went, afternoon, ladies. And they just kind of scrambled off. And the guy that was our guide, Abraham, he come over and he said, don't you do that. And we're like, what? He goes, if her husband saw you speak to her in public, he would beat her. That was just a few years ago in Israel. So, like I said, there's a lot of cultural relevance. So we want to try to preach things and bring things into a context because we do live in a culture. And we have to say, now, why did Paul say what he said? And once we get an understanding of it, we can go, oh, okay, that makes sense now. I understand that. Most people don't know that in the church, there was a wall down the middle of the synagogue. The women sat on one side, the men sat on the other. Well, imagine Ethel over here saying, hey, George, what's he talking about? Woman, shh, be still. Ask him when you get home. Culture. But we have to balance those scriptures with the rest of the Bible, where God calls women to be senior leaders. Apostles. There's 2 apostles in the New Testament named women. Oh, you going to tell me she's when John wrote the 3rd book of John, to the beloved lady and the church who was in her house, there was a senior pastor who was a lady that John wrote a letter to that we call the Holy Bible. So we have to balance the woman question. I have pastors, there's some denominations that to this day, women are looked at as, you know, second class citizens. They're told you're not allowed to ever teach or preach unless you're teaching or preaching to the children. Oh, that's kind of hypocritical. You're not allowed to teach or preach but to the children. That doesn't make any sense. Find that in the Bible. You're not allowed to teach, woman, but if you go to that room with a bunch of little kids, now you can teach. What's the difference between that room and that room? Does God now live in one room and not in the other room? That's hypocritical. So it's out of context. So we're going to do everything we can to establish and build within the context of the Scripture and the revelation of the Scripture. So those who are called Jews and Greeks, man, you talk about blending cultures. Man, I mean, these guys were preaching to Jews who were still mad at that guy because he didn't wash his hands before he ate, or mad at this guy because he wasn't circumcised. They're all coming to the church. This guy's not circumcised. This guy's doing this. This guy's doing this. They had to work through all these things, just like we have to work through all these things. But in the middle of working through all these things, we can't be divided. We've got to stay together. Why? Because there God commands blessing. And I don't know about you, I kind of like blessing. Amen. For you see your calling, brethren. Man, do you see your calling? You see your calling? Not many wise according to the flesh, not many noble, not many mighty are called. God's called the foolish things of the world. Are you called by God? Foolish thing you? I'm a foolish thing called by God to confound the wise. God chose the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. The weak things of the world to put to shame the things that are mighty. The base things of the world and the things which are despised God has chosen, and the things which are not to bring to nothing the things that are. Why? Let's look at verse 29 together. And let's get it, saints. No flesh. No flesh is going to glory in His presence. Anytime you start exalting yourself above your brother or your sister, I don't care how gifted you are. I don't care if you can sing the notes off the piano. I don't care if you can prophesy the paint off the walls. I don't care if you can cast out Lucifer himself. When you exalt yourself above another, I don't care if you can speak Hebrew, Greek, and every other language on planet Earth. When you exalt yourself above another, you have stepped out of the nature of Christ, and now you are walking in a different spirit, and that spirit will cause division wherever it goes. All of us at times need to just take a step back, take a deep breath, and say, I'm not as great as I may think I am. Anytime you find yourself looking down your nose at another ministry gift, that means you've exalted your nose up above them. We stand eye to eye, brothers and sisters, in gifting. And I'll take character over gifting any day of the week. I want both. But if I got to choose character or gifting, I'll take character. I'll take a sister that can't sing two notes on key over a harlot that can sing the paint off the walls. I'll take character over gifting any day. I was in a meeting just here recently, and I was told about a leader that half his worship team was in sexual sin. And he was confronted about, what are you going to do about this? And he said, if I confront them, they'll leave and I won't have a world-class worship team anymore. I'll sing myself. Before I'll let an adulterer lead worship. I'll get me a kazoo. You know, I'll get me a gazoo and lead worship before I'll let a homosexual take you into the wrong throne room. We're not looking for spiritual perfection up here or out there or anywhere. I expect human beings to make mistakes, and I give grace for that. But I'm talking about iniquity. You who practice iniquity. Iniquity is way past a sin. Iniquity means it's a lifestyle. Iniquity means, yeah, we shacking up and we ain't got no plans of moving out. Iniquity means, yeah, we're in sin, and you know what? We ain't got no plans of getting out of sin. I don't think it's a problem with God. That's iniquity. That means you're bent. So we're going to exalt character over gifting. Thank God we got a lot of people here that have both. Thank God for that. Do you recognize and realize that we have as an assembly some of the most gifted, gracious, wonderful, holy people striving to live right with God? I mean, man, we got some precious saints in our house. But that doesn't mean we can't be divided. In fact, sometimes that gives even a greater opening for the enemy because of pride. Sometimes pride gets in. You know, somebody said to me a while back, so-and-so said they could prophesy better than you could. I just started laughing, and I said, I hope they can, man. I'm not a prophet. Lord, I don't bill myself as a prophet. I build churches. Can I prophesy? A little bit. Come on. Come on, saints of God. Somebody needs to slap themselves. Wake up out of your dream, man. Somebody needs to go back up to heaven and get a big picture again. We're a body. And if the hand says to the foot, I have no need of you. Or if the foot says to the hand, I have no need of you. Body's going to be in a schism. We've been having some epileptic seizures in our body here for the last year. You're the core. I challenge you tonight to pull together like you've never pulled together before. I challenge every group in this church. You know, we try to create groups where, you know, when we're together with this many people, like if I start laying hands and prophesying over people, we'll be here till 3 in the morning to get to every one of you. We can't do that every service. We don't have the time. But we break down into subgroups so we can have more personal ministry time. You know, we break down into subgroups, and these smaller groups, we give people personal ministry that you can't do in a corporate service every week. But when those groups begin to fight,
well, I'm in V life, well, I'm in M life, well, I'm a temple builder, well, I'm a senior saint, well, I'm in the youth.
Yeah, you are. Praise God. That's great. And we need every one of you.
Well, I'm prophetic. I'm evangelistic.
I believe in friendship evangelism. We need you too. Because if you don't bring someone in here, we won't have no one to prophesy to. Because, you know, a lot of times people to prophesy, they don't bring a whole lot of people in. Why, they're kind of up there. Not bad. It's just, you know, sometimes people are flowing at different levels. Well, you know what? I used this illustration last summer in our summer camp when I brought my big striper bass out here that I have mounted. And I said, you know, when I wanted to fish for him, I didn't throw out what I wanted to eat. I didn't throw out a chicken strip, deep fried, double battered. I didn't throw out a Korean French fry. I threw out a little white bass. That's what he liked to eat. And a lot of times we forget we have to catch fish before we can clean them. And sometimes we try to catch fish with the bait we want to eat. You know, one thing I want to do again real soon is I want to get a religious comedy night. You know, one of our great families in this church, Cam and Angela, I don't know, they're here tonight. Well, they're a great family in the church. You know how they got here? Cam said this. He said, "You got me." You know what we did? We invited, or Heath actually, I think, invited him to a comedy night, and we snuck in some praise and worship. Well, Angela liked the comedy, and Cam liked the praise and worship. And guess what? We caught a good family, and they've been a blessing in this house ever since. Amen. I mean, you know, Elevate, they catch fish all the time. Maybe not the way the youth does, or I would. Maybe not the way the worship team would. Thank God you're catching fish. Thank God you're catching fish. So why you wanna diss someone that ain't doing it the way you do it? I ain't gonna diss the person don't want to do it the way I'm like, we need all of you. Why? There's a whole bunch of different kind of fish out there. You know, if you go down to the river, you have to select a bait for each species of fish. Human beings are all different. One will respond to a comedy show. The other will respond to a drama. The other will respond to a prophetic word. The other one will respond to music. The other one will respond to good preaching. There's some people, they come here, they don't even come till after the worship service. They say, "I don't like the music, but I like your preaching." I don't diss the worship team. Say, "Why don't you guys just preach my sermons for your songs?" That wouldn't work very well. But I don't diss them. And there are some people that say, I come to, you know, when we look at comments from visitors to this church, you wouldn't believe how many comments we get from people that says, what was your impression of the Rock? And they say, "I love the worship." And I'm thinking, well, what about the preaching? Didn't say a stinking word about the preaching. I just love the worship. You know what? I'm not going to get up and diss the worship team. I'm like, thank God. God used worship as bait for that fish. I'll get them to preach to. If your worship gets them in here, I got someone to preach to. If my preaching gets them in here, you got someone to lead in singing. If your picnic gets them in here, then I got someone to prophesy to. If your prophecy gets them in here, then we got someone to have a picnic with. Hello! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay, we're going to play that video one more time for the closing tonight. And I want you to think before you speak. You know, the Bible says, be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Man, why don't you begin to support and exalt one another in a brand new way? Won't you begin to encourage one another, saying, "Dude, heard you had a great senior saint meeting, man. I heard this happen the other day in M Life. Man, I heard this happen the other day at Temple Beach. Man, I heard this happen the other day. I heard it down at Elevate. Man, I heard that 12 people get saved in the city park the other day." That's how we're going to continue to grow, core. That's how we're going to continue to grow. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed, brethren, lest you be consumed by one another. Amen. You play that video one more time. Never hurt. made up our minds to leave it all behind. And the light began to fade in the city on the hill. City on the hill. Instead of standing strong together, they let their differences divide. Then one by one, they ran away with their made-up minds to leave it all behind. And the light began to fade in the city on the hill. The city on the hill. And the world is searching.
Come on.
What's the rhythm of the dancers that gave the poets life? It was the spirit of the poets that gave the soldiers strength to fight. It was the fire of the young ones. It was the wisdom of the old. It was the story of the poor man that needed to be told. Hallelujah. I challenge you, Core. I challenge you. Give people something to join. Give the city something to join. Give the city something to join. There's a cry. People need to join the body of Christ. They need to see something they can join. They can't join division. They can't join division. They can only join vision. Amen? Give them something to join. I encourage every leader in this house to support every other leader in this house. You're different by design. You're not supposed to be the same. If you're all the same, it'd be boring around here. You're all the same, we'd only have a one-dimensional church. You're all the same, we would be a lopsided ministry. We need mercy. We need grace. We need judgment. We need authority. We need love. We need it all. We need prophecy. We need it all. We need the gifts. We need the word. We need the Greek. We need the Hebrew. We need all of it. It's just when we turn on each other, we look like fools. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Stand with me tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Boundaries and the gifted church.
boundaries and the gifted church. Father, tonight I thank you for your word, and I pray that we would stand together in the spirit of unity stronger than we've ever stood before, as we know that the darkness of this earth is growing in intensity. Let the light of Christ shine brighter still. Lord, we want to be that city on a hill. We don't want to lose our shine. We want to be that city on a hill. You know, Casting Crowns didn't write this song for the Rock. They wrote this song for every church they see as they travel across this world preaching the gospel of Christ. They go into church after church, and their hearts, I guarantee, have been vexed and grieved by what they've seen in churches, and that's why they wrote this song. They see the division as they go out and try to evangelize in music and get criticized. They see what's going on, and it was the heart, I believe, of God that wrote this song through this group. Amen. Let's fulfill our call. Amen. Get my prayer team up here tonight. Thank you for hanging with me.